Okay. Thanks, thanks all. Thanks for joining this particular session on dual maintenance dashboard. So the idea was like in the last session. Let me just share my screen first of all. Yeah. Okay. So the idea was in the last session with Vinay and team, we thought, okay, so DMD is one of the tools which we are trying to use in multiple projects. So we thought as technical team, so it'll be good to have a session, internal session with all of you, because you're all part of HMC. So it is important that you all understand. So you understand, you all should understand the capabilities of this tool, dual maintenance dashboard, and where and all we can use this. And because we will be working on multiple HMC projects, and there will be scenarios. For example, in Vodafone, we started using this tool in multiple projects. Vodafone, BAT, EAD Parry, we already started. We are proposing in Arkema, and few other projects also we have proposed. And even Manoj is also considering that, I think, in SIPCAP. So we need to understand, we need to see where and all we can use this. So to make the decision, I think it is important for you to understand the capabilities of this tool, and also for people, I think for developers, it is important that how this tool works. So what I'm going to do is, I'm going to go through some of these slides which talks about what is DMD, and where exactly this tool can be used, and I'll just go through a few slides, then we'll talk about the purpose and use, where and all it is used. Then we'll quickly jump on to a demo session. We'll quickly go to SAP system in one of my client system, where we'll try to show you the exact purpose of. Okay, so stop me wherever you have any questions. Stop me and ask me so that we can discuss. Okay, some of the questions I think probably will be answered when you see the demo. So probably I'll hold those questions. I'll try to answer those questions once the demo is started. And guys, there's some issue with my headphone. So if you cannot hear me properly, please raise. Please let me know. Okay. So I'll just start with the slide. Hopefully you can see my screen. So let's start with this one. So this is our DMD logo and all. This is the team, and that's me and the guys from HMC only. So we're all worked on this particular tool. So let's not. Okay, now I think most of you know what is the dual maintenance and all. I think there are some freshers also there in the call, and there's a few other team members. Just to quickly tell you what is dual maintenance, because we're all technical people, so we're not going to the detail and all. So we're talking about upgrade projects. We'll have multiple landscapes. So normally what happens is, you have your normal, normal landscape where your normal support ticket will go on. At the same time, when you do upgrade, so you'll have your parallel system. So now what happens is, when the upgrade project is in progress, so the expectation is that, whenever there is a new ticket or new change comes in your normal landscape, you'll have to replicate the same change in both places, in the current landscape. And at the same time, you are upgraded system as well. Just think from your project perspective, it is much clearer. And this should be done till go live. Any changes which is done in your current landscape, current active landscape, you will have to replicate the same change in two places. The second place, why we are doing it, we have to make sure that the change will work after upgrade also. So for that, you do the change and you ask the functional team or whoever is responsible, ask them to test it. Okay, for that purpose, dual maintenance is very important. It's not just development. We are talking about customizing requests as well. So that is the dual maintenance part what we are talking about. And now, how we normally do it? First of all, in the current landscape, let's skip this slide. I'll come to this one. Yeah. Okay, I'll just quickly say how we normally do it. So we have two landscapes. So normally you will have to manually understand what are the transports which are going to production. So, maybe on a daily basis, maybe on a weekly basis, but depending on the project. And then you'll have to understand, whether the change can be replicated manually here in the upgrade system. Okay, let's call the upgraded system as target system and the active landscape as source system. Okay, So source is your current landscape, target is your upgraded system, okay, to make it more simpler. Now coming back to this slide, so ideally you'll have to repeat the same changes, you'll have to manually. So how you normally do it without this tool, you have to manually check the transport, you have to manually identify what transport went into production, then you have to compare each and every object from your current transport, check in the target system, see if there are any changes done in the system locally for standardization, for simplification, maybe for upgrade EHA fixes. What is that? So those kind of checks should be done manually, and then you'll have to manually decide whether the, you know, like the transport can be imported or whether you have to manually repeat it. So these are all things which you normally do in a manual process. There's no automation generally involved. So there are some tools available like Transport Express and all. That covers only certain part of it. Okay, it doesn't cover end to end. Okay. Now this is the existing scenario. Let's talk about how DMD is going to help you in this. Okay. We'll talk about DMD, but any questions so far, anybody, or I'll just quick to am I going very fast, or is it okay, guys? Any questions you have?
Yeah.
Okay, good. So now talking about DMD. So how this is going to help you? Okay. Now we have built it from HMC. We have now created this tool. We have worked on this tool. And what this is doing, that's why I mentioned source and target system. You see the names are mentioned there. So source is your old system and target is your upgraded system. Now what is happening here is, okay, the whole process you have tried to automate. Now in your source system, I said whatever manual activity we have to do. So now what we are going to do is there will be a job, background job, which will on a daily basis, it will pick up all the transport. There is a separate program we have written for that. Okay, so that will pick up all the transport which are moved to your production, for example. And it will just, using an RFC function module, it will move the transport number into a custom table in the target system. You see there on your right side. So you will, the only the transport numbers will be moved to that particular table now on a daily basis. Every day this job will run. Now, in the target system, on a daily basis, somebody has to manually come here. So the only manual part is this dual maintenance dashboard, what you see here in the target dev system. This is what is a manual activity. So somebody has to come here. They have to run this particular program, second program, which is there in the upgraded system. It's basically a dashboard which picks up all the transports from the custom table. Okay, only the transport numbers and the related objects will be there. And it will do all kind of conflict analysis. It will tell you, okay, in this transport, there are maybe 10 objects are there. Okay, for standardization or maybe for simplification or for EHPA bug fix or for some reason you have done some changes in the target system itself. Okay, so and if you want to import transport from the source system, it will overwrite your current change. And what is the reason? This particular object has some local changes. So this sort of analysis, you don't have to manually do it. On a click of a button, you will be able to see it in a pop-up window. You'll be able to see it. I'll show you in the demo, then it'll be much clearer for you. Now just understand that all these conflicts are handled here. Not just that conflict. If there is an object dependency, say if the same object is locked in multiple transport which are coming in the source system, assume that, okay, you're going to import it in the wrong sequence. So all that part is also covered. You have analysis for standard object, you have analysis covered for TOCs, you have analysis done for customizing requests as well. Huh? Customizing requests, we check the structure on both systems and we give an analysis based on that. Okay. So these are some of the conflicts which are handling here. Okay. So what happens is once the conflict is done, suppose assume that, okay, you identified some conflict, like, oh, in the same object, you have done some standardization changes. So in the tool itself, we have provided different provisions. I'll show you that. It looks like, okay. So it looks like this, okay. So in the tool itself, we have provided some provisions, like, you know, in your current screen, what you see here is basically the dashboard output. Okay, so this is the dashboard output what I was talking about. And the third column what you see is the is basically the list of transports from the source system, from the lower version. All these transports are in production. Now basically now in the target system, in the upgraded system, we are running this dashboard and basically tells you that, okay, on this particular date, 1-2 something, or 2-2-2019, 4-2, for every date, the time is also given. These transports are moved to production. Now you decide whether you want to import this into your current system or not. This is what basically this tells you. And on your right side, there are two important columns. One is your comment section, and the second one is your status bar. And this is where you get, okay, whether there are any conflicts, local transport conflict identify, please check object list. There is a red button. So if there is a red, if there is a grayed out button, if there is a yellow, you will not be able to import it. There is a import button, transport import button in your manual, in your application bar. You will not be able to use it until it is green for that particular transport. So now, for example, whatever you see in the screen, nothing is green now. Just an example, I have the screenshot. So what do you have to do? Just select, for example, the 8840 transport. I have double click, and you see in a pop-up, I get all the list of objects. And it tells me that, okay, what is the conflict? Okay, this particular object is locked in local transport in the target system itself. Okay, so now what to do? Now there is a conflict. Okay, I have identified that there is a conflict. Now what I can do? Okay, so there are three options. Either obviously you have to compare it. You need to see what is the change. So you select that line, and there is a compare button, the yellow marked one you see there. Okay, so you have to click on the compare button, and similar, you're familiar with SE39, I guess. So it's similar to your SE39, you're going to get a split screen editor automatically in the tool itself, and you'll be able to compare it. You'll be able to see what changes are there between the source system transport and the target system. Target system is basically your annotation changes or simplification changes in case of S4HANA. So you'll be able to compare it, you'll be able to decide whether the change can be ignored or you want to merge both changes. If you want to merge both changes, you'll be able to do it here itself. So you have the split screen editor, left side is your system, the target system, which is open. Don't worry about the screenshot, I'll show it because I've taken it from the same system, don't worry about it. So you'll be able to merge it, you'll be able to merge the code, and you'll be able to save it here itself. And just in case you think that, okay, maybe the change is only in a comment line or something, you don't want to, you want to ignore it, still it's possible, you select that line, click on object OK. So that means, okay, so two options. Depending on the case, either we can ignore that particular change itself, you can just say ignore TR, or you can accept, you can make it green. When you say object OK, this particular line will be changed to green. And the corresponding transport line will also be turned to green. Then you'll be able to import it. So depending on the case, you'll have to compare it, similar to what you do in SPAW. You have to compare the version, understand it, what is the change, whether you want to import it or you want to merge it, whether you want to ignore it. So everything is controlled here. Okay, so this is important. So I'll show you what are the other conflicts we cover before we move on to the demo. Any questions in this particular slide here? Anybody?
Yeah, Gokul, Manoj here.
Yes, Manoj.
Yeah. So my question is, in the target system, we have done the annotation, right?
Right.
And in the, for X program, and in the source system, I added or modified some 4-5 lines.
Right.
Okay. Now you said that daily the job will run, and that transport is moved in production in source. Now it will come to custom table. Then I will go to split screen and see those changes. Now, now the tool will automatically automate those changes, or we have to do manual retrofit?
No. So this manual retrofit, that is the only part you are going to do. Okay. See, first of all, I'll just show you the screenshot. So what you see here, this is an activation part. Don't worry about it. This is a one-time activity which you have to do. And second one, the current screen, what you see there, this is the transport collection job which will run in your source system. Okay.
Yeah.
And import reference system, as you said, this will be your production one. So any transport, we'll give the date and the reference, we'll give the RFC designation, both systems, source and target system.
So the
yeah.
Source system will push all the transport to the custom table in target system, right?
Correct. Not all the transport, any transport so which are moved
which
to...
Is, which is to production, whatever. Yeah.
Correct, correct. Absolutely.
Right.
You go to the custom table. And this is an automated job. So nobody is going to touch it here. Okay, now comes, and this is now output what you get from the source system in the job log and all. So that's why I skipped that. This is the only transaction which somebody has to run it manually. This is the manual thing which somebody has to run, and somebody has to do in the target system.
Okay.
And this is the main dashboard. The DMD dashboard is ZIVM_DMD. And what it has, so what it shows is basically you can run it for a specific day and maybe a description that is also added now, so old transport, old screenshot. And this will give you the output what I showed you earlier.
Once you run,
this is something which you have to manually run it, and you will go to get this conflict analysis which is already done. So now you see, just think about it. Instead of doing any manual analysis source system, you're directly simply running this, somebody has to run this transaction on a daily basis. You'll just directly see it. Okay, what are the transports which went to production in the source system? You will see that, and you'll be able to see the analysis as well. You'll see that, okay, whether is it okay to import it? You will be able to select that. You will be able to compare it to see what changes are done. And this is something which you have to manually do. The merging part, you'll have to do it because there is no other tool which will help you as of now.
Okay, so this tool will help for manual analysis, right?
Manual analysis. This is mainly to reduce your manual effort. Okay. So manual effort, you know, spend for analysis and conflict part. This will help. For example, Vodafone, they have predicted around 60% of reduction in manual effort. Okay. So and BAT also they have started using it.
Okay.
What kind of conflicts it is giving you? That is what these screenshots are basically telling you. Okay. And any TOCs you have created in your source system and you have moved to your target system, again, instead of manually checking it, okay, this tool will tell you, okay, there is a TOC created for the same object and which is moved to the target system. That analysis is also done. Any dependencies between your between the object in the source system transport itself. They assume that there are 10 transports and the same object is locked in multiple transports. That kind of analysis is also that kind of conflict is also shown here. So you cannot change the sequence. So it will make sure that you are following the correct sequence. And local transport, I think I already mentioned. So if there are any local changes done, again you're not manually checking it. You know what transport now you see. In your current screenshot 95578, basically this tells you that okay, you will not be able to import this 3857 transport because it is locked in another local transport. So these kind of analysis it is basically telling you. And after that, once you import it, the traffic light will be changed to gray color so that you will not be able to re-import it. Unless you want to re-import it, you can go through the same process. You can convert it back to green and you can re-import. But generally, the traffic light will be changed to gray color. So you will not be able to import it. Okay. So these are the different conflicts. I'll show you in the demo. Probably it will be much, much, much more interesting than going through all these, this thing. Just to conclude, we have two other options. You will be able to run it for the customizing request as well. I'll show it in the demo. And another one interesting point. Transport collection, once you complete all your dual maintenance part, again now we are talking about external transport, we are talking about some local changes, there will be a lot of transport for the same object, for example. So that sequence you don't have to worry, because the same sequence you have to send it to the quality, you have to send it to the production. Now this option, collect transport list option, what you see in your current screen will give you that correct list in the correct sequence, considering both external and internal. And this is the input for your basis team. You'll be able to download it and you'll be able to give it to the basis team. They'll follow this sequence for the next subsequent systems. Okay, so just one few advantages I thought I'll cover. I missed that because I thought those are all important.
So, Gokul, one more question, Manoj. So the prerequisite is the RFC connection, right, between source and target?
Absolutely,
right? Yes. And secondly, first run will be a delta run, right? And there will be huge transports, right?
Okay, I'll cover that. Okay, now, so one of my points I thought I'll add is cover that point actually. Like, you know, so you have to start your DMD from a certain date, right? So what
mm-hmm.
happens is we have split this particular activity into two parts.
Okay.
So till you start your daily job, you'll have to run the delta transport. So that is the first part.
Mm-hmm.
So when the system was copied, when the upgraded system was copied initially, from that day to till date, let's say till today, you'll have to run the delta transport. What that means is, okay, there'll be huge number of transport, which is one time activity basically you have to do. And after that, you'll have to schedule the manual job. After that, it's only on a daily basis, you'll have to deal with only the daily transport. Okay, so this is what we have to do on a daily basis. And for technical guys, technical point, like even this particular tool will give you the dependencies between function modules and function group, class and method. This, I think most of you know that, okay, when you send the function module first time, only the function group is locked, and the subsequent ones, you'll get the function module. So if you have that kind of dependencies in two different transport, normally in the manual check, it is normally missed. So this tool will check that dependency as well. Same with class as well. Huh? You have your method and class, so that dependency is also checked here. Same about REPS and PROG, programs and the REPS element, REPS one. So these kind of dependencies, which you normally don't get it in any other tool, or if you want to do it manually, I'm pretty sure it is very difficult to do that. So these kind of checks are also done here. Okay. So just wanted to highlight few points. Just hold on to your, I'll just go through the demo, then you can ask me your question, further questions, Manoj, and others also. Yeah. Or any other questions in the slide you want to ask now, Manoj, first of all, I'll ask you.
No, I'm clear.
Right. Anybody else? Any other question? You'll have to.
No, no, Gokul, we are fine. You can go ahead.
Right. Okay. Now, what I'm going to do is, I'm going to show you the target system. Source system, it is quite clear. What I told was, like, no, you're going to collect all the transports. There will be a background job which will collect all the transport on a daily basis. You send it to a custom table, I said. Okay. So now I'm going to run only the target system dual maintenance dashboard. Okay, I'll just show you. This is the transaction. This is the program. The program name and all I'll give you later. It's there in the document. I'll run it for a specific date range, which I thought, okay, it'll be quite interesting. First of all, let me go back. You see, there are quite a few options here. I've just gave only the date range. You can select whether you want to run it for workbench or customizing. We want to include TOCs. Give the RFC destination. I said, okay, both development systems should be connected. This is important point, guys. We are going to run this tool only in development system. Even though you're going to consider the transport which are moved to production, this tool will be available only in the development system. You don't have to move this tool anywhere, even not to quality. Just keep it in development system itself. That is enough. The tool will search the transport log, and it will just give you that correct information. Okay. So if you want to restrict it for any particular project, let's say star, some project with a description, transport owner, or specific programs, well, so you can all now use that if you really want. But generally, we'll give only the transport dates. And let me run again. Okay, now this is the output, which I wanted to highlight. See, this is an active client system. Where the DMD tool is currently used. Okay, this is not a sandbox or something. This is something which is used currently by the client. Okay, I'll just give you some examples here. Transport, local transport conflicts identified, please checklist. Let's see this transport. This is a red one. What you see here, it's a red one. Okay, so it tells you that, see, 108, it tells you that, this, what is the system name? This is ESD system. See, the system name, the target system is ESD and the source system is EDD. Okay, keep that in mind. So we are trying to import some transport from EDD system. It is not imported yet. Keep that in mind. EDD something 1038, it is not imported yet. it tells you that, okay, you're trying to import it, but the same object, same report is locked. It changed in some other ESD transport in the current system, in the upgraded system. So that's why you're seeing it as a red. So maybe it was changed by someone, it is changed by the time, date is also there. I think if you scroll to the right, you'll see it. So now you see that. Normally what happens if you do this manually, you'll have to go to each program, you'll have to identify what config and all. Now you'll be able to see here it. Okay, now you select what next. Now you see that there is a config. Now you select it. Now I said, okay, these are the different options you have. The yellow marked one, which I showed in the PPT. Now come on, let me compare it. Okay, now just see the transport number is 971038. So what it is going to do is there is an RFC connection there, that which I already mentioned, which already entered in the selection screen. It is going to compare the version between your current EDD and ESD, and it is going to tell you what are the changes you have. Okay, now you see this is the normal split screen editor. You get it, it's more of a version management. You see the version 970138, this is the transport which you're trying to import, and this is the current active version in your target system. And you will be able to compare using this button. As you all know, you'll be able to see if it says the programs are not identical. You'll be able to go through the next one. What is the difference? I think most of you guys are already familiar with this. So you can easily go to the change mode. Okay, so you'll be able to make changes. Whatever change is there, I'm not going to make any changes. This is my client system. Probably they'll kill me, so I'll not do that. So so the idea is that you compare it and you make any changes you want to make here. Okay, so just one important point. Please note that you're seeing that particular transport here. Okay, assume that you have after this EDD 1038, there's one more change done for another transport. Okay, so so that will not be taken care of. It is like the changes specific to that transport you'll be able to see here. Okay, there is a specific code written for that. So don't worry if you have multiple transport on top of the current one, which are not moved to production. Manoj, that's a valid scenario for you, I think, right? There is one transport which is moved to production and you want to replicate only that change.
Yes.
And on top of it, assume that there is one more new ticket has come in, but still people are testing it. You don't want to replicate it. Now, here in this comparison, you're not going to compare the active version. You're going to compare that particular version from the transport. Okay. So in that way, you're making sure that you are only doing the changes which are in production. Okay, this was another tricky point. Earlier we used to show only the active one. So now we have made some changes to make sure we are just showing only the correct transport version. Okay, so this is also done. Okay, and you'll be able to make any changes here, and you'll be able to save it in the current transport. I'm not going to save it. And what that means is now you merge the changes. In this field, this transport fixed field is it's an active editable field. So you will just replace it, either you'll retain this particular transport, because whatever changes you make will be saved in the transport itself. At the end of the day, you need a final transport for this particular change. So you can decide whether which transport you want to keep it, it's up to you. Okay. Or if you think that, okay, I don't want to import EDD 9701038, select it. Once you've done the changes here, select it, just say ignore TR. Okay. Or if you want to ignore this transport, ESD 900251, you don't want that changes because of whatever may be the reason. Select it, say object OK. So this will be turned to green. Then it will allow you to import it. You see the button there, right? On the background, transport import. You'll be able to import it similar to STMS. You don't have to go to STMS here. So you will be able to make it green, and then you, for example, this is green, right? I'll not import it. I'm just saying if you select this transport import, it will allow you to import it. All other transport which are red or yellow, you'll not be able to import it. Okay, any questions?
Yes, Google is one small question.
Yeah.
So when you are saying transport import, so which transport it will import, either from the source system or the transport fixed TR?
No, from the source system. Now we are only talking about importing the transport from the source system. It's all about importing the source system. If you don't want to import the source system transport, we'll just simply say ignore transport. That will be grayed out. The traffic light, what you see on the right side, the color will change to gray.
Okay, so the changes we are doing with that particular TR, what will happen to that?
Because see, the transport is, there's a ESD transport. For example, they want, which example I took? This one, is it?
1038.
If you check this one, see, this is a ESD 900251. This is already there in the current system, ESD system, target system.
Okay.
So you don't have to import it, right? So this is already there in the current system, and this is the active transport. What we are telling the system is that the version in ESD 900251 is the active version. For whatever reason, probably you merged the ticket changes into your sanitization changes here in this transport. You don't need EDT transport anymore. Okay. So you can just select it, just say ignore.
Let's take one case where I have not done any transport fix here.
Mm-hmm.
I have only this EDD K91038.
Okay,
so that time there won't be any conflict, right? It will be directly imported.
Correct. Okay, that'll be, so another one which I showed you earlier, for example, EDD, this one, for example.
Can be imported cases.
See, transport fix is blank. See, in this case, the analysis is done automatically. It has checked for all the, conflicts and all. And this particular object, what you see there, this object, all four objects doesn't have any conflicts. There are no local changes there. That's why the transport fix field is blank. That way, all are green. So what that means is you can simply easily select this line, and you can use this transport info.
Okay, so in that case, that harmonization question is coming to me. So let's say the production version having older version.
Hmm.
Okay, let's say there's a VBUK select code, but VBUK code is not in HANA project, HANA system. So when I press the transport import, so that code will be imported in HANA system, isn't it?
Absolutely. Correct.
Let's
say there are two scenarios. There are two scenarios. One, first scenario is when you have already done the annotation changes, okay, the same program. For example, in this program itself, assume that you have done the annotation. ZVS_GLGRP_BU, you have done the annotation changes. When you run that, at that scenario, when you run this tool, you will get a transport fix. There is a conflict deployment. You'll see here. And then what you have to do is you have to use the compare option, go to that split screen editor to make sure, okay, instead of importing the TR, you will have to manually, redo the changes which are coming from the active landscape, okay? And that is one scenario. And second one is, assume that the annotation is not done yet, okay? So similar to what you see here. For example, there's no annotation needed for this particular program, okay? EDD, so you will have to allow the tool to import this EDD transport. That transport will be imported. After that, the project team, they have to decide whether there is any harmonization or simplification changes to be done. That they have to follow the normal process.
Okay, so the
point is, you can use this tool anytime, either before harmonization or after harmonization, still it works. It is applicable for both scenarios.
Okay, so in non-harmonization case, once we import that report in our new system, HANA system, so the activation of the program will happen after the TR import. So that time it will end up with the RC8, right? Saying some syntax error is happening. Okay.
Syntax error will be there. Then that means you need to redo it, obviously, because you're applying the change here in the HANA system, S4 HANA system. Normal SOH will work, but in the S4 HANA system, if you're doing it, obviously it's not allow you to, activate.
No, it's clear.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, Rajesh, one more question, yeah.
So Gokul, if we have objects in one TR and only one which has a conflict, so in that case also we'll have to do manually, but it may be bigger effort. So do we have anything for that in the tool that can help us out?
That's why you have to compare the scenario with the current situation, how we are dealing it right now. Okay, why when Manoj asked, okay, when the initial, see, this will not help you in merging, first of all, it can be very clear. Huh? There's no tool anyway, as of now, as far as I know, there's no tool to help you to merge it. But now, this is more about the analysis part. Now, just current scenario is more about, for every, whatever you see in the current screen, assume that if the tool is not available, you will have to manually do all these checks. So this is only for one particular date range and so on. Huh?
Okay.
So you have to do the analysis. You will have to check for each and every object, look for the different conflicts, look for different reasons what I listed earlier. And then you decide, then you go back to the source system, then compare it and redo the changes, merge it, etc. And all you're doing it, the effort needed is huge. Okay. And that's why I said this tool will help you in the analysis mainly. And then if you want to merge it, still there is some sort of manual effort needed, but you will be able to do it. Even though, as you said, there's only one object, still you'll have to compare it. Okay, you know what changes are more, whether annotation changes are more or the support changes are more. So you'll be able to decide in the pop-up screen what I just
got it. Yeah, sure. Yeah.
So Gokul.
Mm. Thank you.
Like if Manoj here, so if support changes are more, then ideal situation is we import the TR, right?
Absolutely.
So that the source and target are same, and then we do the annotation.
Absolutely.
Again.
Your point is very valid. That's why we have given two options. Now,
okay.
I think you touched upon a very important point.
Yeah.
The question is, why we should do the analysis? What is the other one? Yeah, this one, I think. Okay. Now, as technical people, we decide after the comparison, you have to decide which changes are more. The support changes are more,
yes,
or the analytical changes are more. If
yes,
the support
right.
changes are more, ideally we should allow the transport to be imported. Okay,
mm-hmm.
select
right.
it, make it object okay. Then bring the annotation change. You'll have to make sure that annotation TR is released. Anyway, otherwise it will not allow you. There is a validation done here. It will not allow you to import it, just for your information. So that your version will be there. So you will import the support changes. On top of it, you will have to redo the annotation, assuming that the annotation changes are there. So the important point is, in the comparison, you will have to decide which changes are more. You will have to see, maybe compare the lines and see, then decide which changes are more, whether to allow the tool to import the TR or to ignore the TR. That you have to decide. As technical people, that is something which we have to decide. Either when you say we, I'm talking about either project team or, I don't know. See, ideally, we expect the project team to do this activity. Yeah? This is more of a tool from our side. We give to the project team and expect project team to work on it. Huh? Probably from analytical perspective or simplification perspective, we help them. Ideally, but this should be handled by the project team. Okay. So, did I answer your question? Somebody else was asking something.
No, okay. So has Manoj's point been covered? Because I wanted to say something.
Manoj, did I answer your question?
Yes, yes, yes.
Yeah,
okay.
Nice.
Yeah, so for everyone, I mean, this is for everyone to understand that normally, people who work in, are used to working in implementation projects and AMS projects, typically transports would not move between systems other than your normal dev to QA to prod. Okay, transport strategy. Now, although we are looking at this tool, we need to understand that in the perspective of upgrade, the source and target will be, I mean, not always will be, but maybe, okay, maybe completely different. So if it's a support pack upgrade, then the ECC level will remain same, the EHP level will remain same, only the support pack is different. So in that case, the NetWeaver remains the same as well as your NAP stack remains the same. So in that case, transport between those two systems, direct import, okay, it is okay. SAP is also not object. When it comes to EHP differences, so you're going from EHP 5 to say EHP 7, at that EHP level also, SAP will generally not recommend transports moving from a lower system to higher or vice versa. Okay. Technically, it is possible. Technically, you press the import button, it is simply going to overwrite or it is going to create the version. So except for support pack upgrade, if it's an EHP upgrade, if it's a version upgrade, if it's a change of database, if it is a change of NetWeaver, then this tool, in my opinion, should be considered important from a comparing point of view. But when you have to think of that import button, you have to think what the client is going to say about this, how much we are confident in case we are going to tell the client that we are going to move the transports cross system, okay, and cross SAP versions. Okay, technically it is feasible.
See, I just want to add one point here, Vinay. Your point is valid. At the same time, this is something we're talking about custom transport, custom objects. We're not at all talking about standard. That's why if you see standard object, it's always red. And as you were saying, it's not advisable to import anything which has standard object. So that's why any standard object, we simply give that as red. So that, because it can be from OS or Node or something, we don't want to allow them to import it. And
yes.
But in case of Z object, what we say is, okay, even though we're talking about two different releases, so in a very rare case, maybe there may be an obsolete function, but that's a very rare case. But generally, we're talking about Z program, that is quite possible. It's okay to transport, in my opinion, unless there are any huge differences in the code or something. So that's the reason. This particular analysis will give you the comparison, and based on that, you can decide what changes are there. If there is an obsolete function module, or if there are huge changes due to HANA, S/4HANA, something, or if there is a huge impact, that while doing the comparison, probably we'll know. Then based on that, probably we'll be able to decide. Since we're talking about Z program, the risk is less, comparatively less, in my opinion. Okay, standard, I completely agree. There is no way you should import it. It's not imported at all. Because if there is a OS and node done in the lower version, probably it is not relevant at all for the higher version. Absolutely no, it should not be done. That's why we always show that as red. Any standard object, we show that as red. We're not allowing them to import it. Okay, so this is my opinion, and this is what, and even EID pair, which has S/4HANA, they are following it up.
Gokul, technically, like I said, technically everything is possible, but what I want everyone on the call to understand, yes, there is this difference between SAP and non-SAP objects, right? So rule number one, always SAP does not recommend moving transports between different systems with different versions. Okay, now if it is already agreed and okay at the project level, it is perfectly fine.
Correct. Yeah.
Okay. So it is perfectly okay.
Right. You should discuss the project. Absolutely. I agree with your point. I think we should discuss. This is one point. I think we should, while discussing with the client, we should highlight that, okay, we are going to move across, different versions, and we should highlight that, as you rightly said, along with the other points. Yeah, absolutely. I agree.
Yeah, because dual maintenance, when you actually go to projects, it will be at two different, there are two different categories of dual maintenance. And sometimes the projects, the clients themselves might have an N and N plus one landscape, which means they keep toggling between the two landscapes from time to time. So in
Correct.
That case, both the landscapes are generally at the same SAP level. So they're using a tool, even SAP also gives you a standard tool to transport versions between systems. Okay, this scenario that we are covering right now is very specific to upgrade, where there may always be a difference. It is just that difference might be at the level of support pack or an EHP or a version or a completely different product such as S4.
Correct, absolutely. Yeah, agree.
So everyone just should remember that.
We should highlight it. Absolutely agree. I think we should discuss with the project team. I think I'll add few more quick points. So few other important points I thought I'll add. Just wanted to show this example as well. 1051. Just picked up this one. Will be a good example. So this is again we are telling that okay EDD 9710. So there is a dependency in another EDD transport from the source system itself. There is a conflict, so that's it. Hello, and you see that 970787 is there in the same list on the top, the second item. Second item is not yet imported, whatever reason. Okay, it is even this case is green, and basically it tells you that you import the first one, and then only I'll allow you to import it. So the key point here is in 1051 you have the method actually. The second one, actually, it was not there. In our tool, actually, it picks up the corresponding class as well. And if you go back to the one, 787, it has only the class. So this is the example which I was trying to give earlier. So in one of the transport, you have the class, and in the other one, you have the method. Still, that check is happening here. Now you don't have to manually search it. Now you see it has only the class. I think this is the class, I think. So so that check is also happening here, similar to function group and function module. So you don't have to worry about, okay, if the function group is transported, so that it'll overwrite all the function modules. That sort of things is also checked here. Okay. So standard object, I think I already mentioned, we're not going to import it. Local object, I think I already covered. So when it is green, you'll be able to use this transport import pattern, display transport and all is okay. Now only last 2 points I'll quickly cover. So you have the customizing request part, as I said, you'll be able to cover that as well. If you want to check the customizing request, yeah. This is only mainly for analysis. No? So customizing request, probably similar to what Vinay was saying, I'll not suggest to import it. This is more for your analysis, whether it will check for the corresponding table, it will check whether the structure and the fields and the length of the particular field in each and every table. Suppose it's a multiple entries, it will check each and every entry in this particular list. And if there is a small change, still it will say don't import it. Otherwise, if it is green, okay, so you'll have to understand that the structure is same, then you have to decide whether you should allow them to import it or not. It is something which you can give it to the functional console, let them decide. But don't discuss more on the customizing part, because this tool was mainly built for web-based, frankly speaking. And the last part, collect transport. So this is what I was saying, okay, if you use that for a specific date range, once you complete your the dual maintenance duration, it will give you the list of transport which you can give it to the base system as input. See, you have both ESD, EDD, everything is there. So it's a combination of both. It will consider the imported time and created time or release time, whatever it may be. So it will follow the correct sequence for this ESD system, so that you can follow the same sequence with the corresponding system as well. So you don't have to do the analysis again. Okay, and this is an important aspect which we have added based on some feedback from some of the clients. Like for example, EAD Parry, they wanted this, and this is quite useful. So these are the different features we have, and there are some specific things like filtering part and all. I think I'm not going to cover that. In your invite, I've attached the same PPT, and I've attached the user manual as well. Okay, some people who have not received it, please get it from the if you don't, please let me know. I'll send it to you as well. So you can refer, the same steps are explained those documents as well. Okay, so that's why I'm not going to go through all the filters, and the filter is much easier. What if you want to filter something, do that. That's it. Okay, and for any reporting purpose, once you import it, if you want to see what transport and all, you have the custom table which has the transport fixed field. There is a free comment field is also available, just for your information. If somebody wants to update with any comments for some reason, again, that is also possible. They'll be able to, you know, add any comment, which you can see it in the report. Okay, in the pop-up, there is a comment field. This is an editable field similar to that. If you go to the right side, okay, there is a field there on your right side, object ignore, and on the right side, you'll be able to add your comments there because it is not working. Okay, so all these fields, you'll be able to use it for your reporting purpose. If you want to see what transport went in based on the status, if you want to give a short summary to your client, to a project, you will be able to do it from the project, from the custom table itself, or from the DMD tool itself, depending on your requirement. Based on the status, you'll be able to do it. Okay. And you'll run it till the go live, this one. And once the go live is done, you'll deactivate this tool. You don't need it anymore. Once you have only one landscape, that is the time when you deactivate the whole tool. Right? And that's it about the tool. And the prerequisite, both development systems should be connected. You should have RFC destination connected to both systems, from your source and target system should be connected. And you should have valid users to run this tool. That's it. Apart from that, this tool is completely free. This is done by IBM. So to all our clients, as of now, we are providing it as free as part of HMC. That's it. So I think I covered all points. Any other questions, anybody?
Gokul, maybe I missed. Can we run this in background?
This one, see, I think this is one point. I think again, Vinay raised one of the points. I think processing this fuel maintenance dashboard, you'll have to manually do it because there is some sort of manual analysis involved. And I received a feedback from Vinay. Vinay, I think your point was valid.
This is
I'll
me
cover that.
only.
Yeah, sorry. Yeah,
Gokul,
I know. Sorry. I'm just telling to others. I know it's you, but I'm just telling to others. So the point what he raised was, okay, whatever is green, he said, okay, there should be option to automatically process it and a background job. So that is one option which is in progress. So Vinay, what we are planning to do is we'll have one more option, probably here or something, to process the green one, okay, automatically. So there will be a background job. So only that part will be automated. This because we'll have to manually, any red or yellow, we'll have to manually analyze it. So that we'll have to manually do it. So other green, we'll have a job. So that part is in progress. Once it is
Okay,
ready, I'll add it
so I mean, even I was, I mean, now double thinking based
here.
on the discussion that we had in this call about SAP objects. Also, SAP objects, you're anyways flagging them as red, right?
Red
You're
only,
not all of
always
them.
red. Yeah,
Okay.
always red.
Okay. So fine. So we can have that one button in order to automatically import. But my idea, I mean, what was going in my mind is that if we have a background job, I mean, if we have a option to process this, when I say process means just run the report, do nothing else, just run the report, and whatever ALV listing
Green
that
one.
you have here, okay, if I schedule like a background job which runs every day with the starting date as yesterday and ending date as today, and
Today,
I run
correct.
it every day, maybe that it's a background job that already is run. Whoever is the lead or person responsible can simply go to that background job, take a look, and then decide whether, okay, he has to do something about it or no. And maybe whenever it comes to an actual execution, he will run it in
Right.
foreground.
Right.
So is a background option available, or this ALV, can we get that in background also?
See, this ALV will come, but processing the green ones, we'll have to schedule it. We'll have to.
I don't want processing. When it comes to background, it is just our reporting point of view.
Reporting will come. Automatically, still, we'll be able to run it in background. No issues, it will work. It'll
Okay.
come. That will come.
If you have not checked, just check once and tell me. Then I will. What I'll do, basically, in Adani,
Okay.
shell creation is going to get completed on 9th. Okay,
Okay.
9th of September. That is Monday. Okay, and I'm planning to install DMD as well as IBM HANA console on either Monday or Tuesday, 9th or
Right.
10th.
Right.
Okay. The moment this installation is done, I am going to schedule a background job.
Okay.
So I will need your help
Right.
in actually configuring that background job, also telling what should be the RFC that needs to be set up. And then
Right.
starting Monday, I want that job for DMD to run every day and just report, okay, what is the changes, what is the changes, kitna change gaya, that's it.
Yeah, we can do that, I think. Yeah, we
I
can
mean,
do the
as
current
far as
setup.
Adani, that is my plan.
Sure, we'll do it. Only point was, don't process the green one. I think it's
No,
your.
no processing wala part can be done later. No, there is no
Right.
hurry in that, no hurry.
Right. Well, I think it's okay. I think we can do that, Vinay. I think we'll schedule that. So when you recover, please let me know. We'll send the transfer. That's the final version I'll send it. Right?
Yeah, so Monday or Tuesday, that is only between these 2 days.
Fine. Okay. Right, Vinay. Anybody? So others, any other questions you have, or is it clear? Or we are hijacking the discussion?
Gokul, one small question.
Yeah, Rajesh.
So when you say two development systems connected, okay, so if just maybe a technical question, from where you are taking this comparison of production movement logs? From the source development system to production system, let's say something got disconnected between the source development system to source production system, there's a disconnectivity.
Okay,
So in
I'll
that
give you
case, how
a
does this work?
simple answer. So when you see your development system, if you go to a transport, and if you go to transport, you'll be able to see the transport log, right?
Correct.
You'll be able to see whether the transport has moved to your corresponding quality and production. Okay. Similar way, it is written, code is written in a way that, okay, it will check in the development system itself whether the transport has moved to the import reference system. I'm not saying production. So maybe in the, to make it simple, I said initially production. Any import reference system.
Okay.
In some projects, for example, BAT, in the selection screen, we are controlling that. In BAT, they said they want to have the quality as quality system as import reference system. So any transport which moved to, which are moved to the import reference system will be considered. Okay. So there's no connectivity needed at that point of time. So it will be it will be checked through a separate function module or some code written over there to handle that.
Like, okay.
Similar to what you see in the transport law.
Okay. So in that case, production mode with RC8TRs also will be available here, right?
Absolutely come. See, the point is anything which goes to production will come. Doesn't really matter if it is 8 or 4. Because if it is 8, that means, okay, you have sent another transport to fix it, right?
Correct.
So, absolutely. Anything which goes to production, even if it is an error, you're expecting people to send correct it and send another transport. No? So, that transport will also follow that. Okay.
Yeah,
and
okay.
Unless you want to specifically stop that, so you can come to the dashboard and you can stop it.
Okay.
Yeah, possible. Good question. Yeah, good. Anybody else, any other questions you have?
Okay.
Yeah, somebody was asking something.
I see this tool can save a lot of manual effort. But before this tool, is there any other way that can this activity can be automated, or was it a manual Excel work before this?
There's some background noise. So you're saying, yes, you're asking for any other alternative tool you're saying, or? There was some background noise.
Okay, so I was asking, how was this activity done before this was?
Absolutely.
Standard transaction provided by SAP or a basic tool, something like that?
See, market, there are some tools which can help to only a certain extent. Okay, for example, Transport Express is there, but I don't think the same thing, the end-to-end part is not covered anywhere. Okay, so only certain activities are done in some tools. Otherwise, not what normally we do is, like, at least, Vinay, please correct me if I'm wrong. So this is something which you'll have to manually do it. So you'll have to get the list of transport for that particular date range. We go to SCMS, we import it, get the import history, and then you come here and get the list of objects from E071K or something, you compare it. So that kind of analysis, you have something which you have to manually do it, okay, and compare the object, and then you do it. This is how we normally do it, okay. And even on a daily basis, this is something which is manually handled, and there's no specific tool available for this, actually. And that is the reason this is something which is preferred by some of the projects, and that's quite useful in many places.
We were into some activities
sorry.
In an Excel, yeah.
Sorry, saying again, your voice is breaking. Is it only for me? I don't know.
I was answered. Thank you.
Okay. Thanks. Vinay, you were saying something?
No. I was saying that voice was breaking for us also.
Okay. Yeah. Right. Thank you. Anybody else? Any other question?
No.
I think we were. Are you okay? So the expectation from Vinay is that, okay, we have to. No, we should try to use this tool and ISC in wherever possible, right, Vinay? So
yeah, so
objective.
Yeah, so for everyone who has joined here, so the expectations from senior practitioners is to understand the capability of the tool, because they will understand what the dual maintenance means and its impact and its consequences with respect to both the manual effort, right, that is required. So my expectation from the senior practitioners is understand this tool, go back to your projects, see what kind of manual efforts do they have, okay, and then recommend. And it might be possible that even not just this DMD or IHC2 also, there might be something better that is available with the project. Fine. If there is something better, take the learning and we'll incorporate in the tool. If not, then let's recommend our tool, okay. For the junior practitioners, my expectation is they should understand what dual maintenance means. Before I come to the junior practitioners, one more point for the senior practitioners is, when we do an solutioning for the upgrade, typically we put an assumption, saying that dual maintenance is not in scope of our project team, okay? But from a client's perspective, dual maintenance is a task that is inbuilt in a project plan for upgrade. So it cannot be separated as this is not my work and this is your work, okay? So hence, we need to understand one, what is dual maintenance? Second, what is the impact on the project? Third, how much effort is required for the dual maintenance? And that is the three things which drive to using a tool and automation, okay? And from a solutioning perspective, additionally, it is also required that we, after, you know, we have to budget a person, and in some cases, rare cases, okay, maybe like 5% out of 100, we might have to take the responsibility of dual maintenance. Okay? So, because even though it's a very small percentage, we need to be very crystal clear as to what happens. Okay? So that was for the senior practitioners. For the junior practitioners, the expectation is that you should understand now that every project has a dual maintenance. In whatever project you will go, there will be a team who is doing the dual maintenance. Now, at a practitioner level, you will have a lot of interaction between the AMS team and yourself. Okay, why? Because for every manual retrofit that is done from the BAU landscape into your project landscape, after they induce some change in your system, it might be required that you might have to go back and do some small retrofits yourself. Like Rajesh was mentioning or Manoj was mentioning, the hanatization part. Okay, so it is not just hanatization, there could be many other things. Okay, with respect to syntax, ho sakta hai, or there could be any other more things as well. So you should be aware that there is this something that is happening. This retrofit, after it is done in our project landscape, is then also due for testing. When it comes to testing, also it will give rise to defects. May or may not. Okay. So all that which causes a change in the current code is something that you should be aware of. And hence, I mean, this is something for you at a junior practitioner level. Yeah, so well, that was it, I mean, that I want.
Right. Thanks, Vinay. Okay. Thank you. Thanks all. If you have any more questions, you can also get in touch with us in email or something. I will try to answer that. Okay. So thanks all. Thanks for joining. Thank you.
Thank you, Gokul.
Thank you. Thanks.
Thank you. Bye.
Thanks, Gokul. Bye.